What the heck is Vybar, and should I use it for my candles? That is the topic for today. Let's get into it. Hey everyone, Wade Thomas, the owner of Black Tie Barn Candle Company. Today we're going to talk about Vybar. I originally had this topic planned for a future video, but I've been seeing it come up more and more recently, and it's just kind of that itch I feel like I have to scratch now. So instead of waiting to try to work it into the content I have scheduled down the road, I figured, you know what, let's just do it now. Let's just knock it out now since there are some current questions on this topic. All right, so what is Vybar? If you've never heard of Vybar and never used it in your candles before, you may not even really know what it is. Well, Vybar is a polymer, and if you're familiar with what stearic acid is, Vybar is basically a synthetic alternative to stearic acid. In this video, we're going to talk about the three different main types of Vybar that are out there for candle makers and what the differences are between those and what it brings to the table. What are the pros and cons of using Vybar? And we're going to tackle a few little myths while we're at it. First and foremost, as I said, Vybar is an alternative to stearic acid. It is intended for use in candle making, and it is safe to use. Before we dive into the pros and cons and when you should use it and when you shouldn't, let's talk about the three different types that are out there first. All right, so the first one we're going to talk about is Vybar 103. Now, this was the original kind of traditional Vybar that was first made, and you can see it kind of comes in these little pellet forms. If you're familiar with some soy waxes, Pillar of Bliss, that's more of a grainy, texture, so that's wrong. But if you tried any of the Eco soy waxes before that, before they stopped production on those, it kind of has that material. They're like little pebbles, white pebbles. And so this was the original Vybar. However, it's not very commonly used for most of us unless you make pillar candles. And the reason is Vybar 103 is meant for candles with a melt point up to 150 degrees or so. Definitely don't use Vybar 103 in your container candles. Again, it is really meant for your pillars. Now, that brings me to the second Vybar, and this is the one that most of you are probably already familiar with, if you're familiar with Vybar at all, and that is Vybar 260. It's going to look and feel pretty much exactly the same, which is kind of the tricky part about it. It's a tad softer, so it's meant for container candles and waxes with a melt point of 130 or lower. And so that is why this is the Vybar that I'm seeing a lot of questions on specifically. Vybar 260 will work for container candles and waxes with a melt point under 130 degrees. So that is Vybar 260. Now, the third and final one we're going to talk about, which I've used myself, but I don't know a lot of people using it because it's meant for a very specific type of wax that I don't know a lot of people are actually using. Some of your big box stores use this particular Vybar because they use a particular wax. And that wax is a modeling paraffin wax. Now, this is really a side conversation, but it's worth mentioning right now. This is the wax that you see some new candle makers in some of the candle groups, like on Facebook, for example, bring up these jars that they kind of have this appearance they're not used to. Kind of rough, bumpy tops, almost like it looks like kind of bubbles or something on the top of the wax, and they've got crazy colors and variations in the wax itself. You'll see it a lot with Yankee candles, you'll see it with Goose Creek candles and other big box stores. This is another topic, but there's actually nothing wrong with those candles. A lot of people are posting those thinking there's something wrong with these candles and we shouldn't be so hard on ourselves as candle makers, which I agree with that part. We definitely shouldn't be so hard on ourselves. We are typically our own worst critics. But I did just want to clear up that confusion that the wax is actually meant to look like that. Now, the top sometimes can be a little messier than others, but it's just basically the type of wax that is doing that. It is a modeling paraffin wax, which means the color in the oils kind of cause these crazy looking dynamics in the wax, through the wax as well as on top of the wax. So if you see that kind of weird look, I just wanted to clear up that confusion that there's nothing really wrong with that candle. It may not appeal to you, you may not like it, but it is just that type of wax. And believe it or not, it has a very large market still. In fact, the big box companies still own most of the candle market for that reason. Because while some people don't like the look of that wax, some people do. They really like that variations in the wax coloring. But also, those waxes tend to typically throw very well. Again, whole nother topic of conversation. I'm not really wanting to get into that in this video. But the reason I mention that is because that wax is what this other type of Vybar is for. And that Vybar is called Vybar 343, which is right here. And it is going to look and feel very different than the other Vybars we looked at. This comes in a block, and it is like a very dense, thick. It's almost like if you could take petroleum jelly and freeze it. That's what it reminds me of. It has that kind of tacky feel to it, but it's like rock hard. I break this up with like a little chisel and hammer and something like that, or just cut it up, and then I keep it stored cut up like this in just another container because then it's easier to work with. And when I say it's easier to work with, it's because you should be using Vybar by weight, just like you do with your other materials in candle making. You don't really want to just try to do this by teaspoon or something like that, unless you have already figured out what the weight of Vybar is, each of these Vybars is per teaspoon or quarter teaspoon, then that's totally fine. But Vybar should be added per weight, just like anything else. Typically, Vybar is added at an amount of either 0.5% up to 2% of your candle weight. And I would err on the lower side of that, just because too much Vybar can cause problems. And we'll talk about that here in a minute. But a little bit more about the Vybar 343. What makes this so unique and different, and this is one of the newest types of Vybar out there, it is meant for modeling paraffin waxes. And you might be asking yourself why. Well, typically when you add fragrance oil to a paraffin wax, it is going to cause a modeling appearance. And that's why some of those waxes I talked about are like that by design. That's just its normal state by the time you add fragrance. Well, a lot of the industry has changed paraffin waxes that we buy off the shelves or from our suppliers now to already have another Vybar in it, like Vybar 260. And what that does is it allows that paraffin wax to retain more fragrance oil than it could be, than it could on its own in its natural state. So paraffin waxes generally only hold about 3-5% of fragrance oil. But by adding Vybar to them, which most of the blends already have, that can allow them to hold anywhere between 6-9%, for example. And so that is the main purpose of Vybar, is to increase the holding capacity or the retention of oil in the wax. But when you do that, it also removes all the modeling from that candle. That crazy colory variation throughout the wax. It smoothed it out. And that is why most of the waxes we buy from our suppliers have that opaque look to them. They're smooth and they're creamy. And it's because Vybar has already been added to those blends. Now, I'm not really talking about soy. I'm talking about paraffin right now. It already has Vybar in those blends to increase the fragrance capacity, but it also removed the modeling. So actually, the paraffin and the parasoy blends that you're buying from your suppliers have already added Vybar in the mix. They do not need any more of it. Where this comes in is if you want to use a modeling wax, you need to increase the fragrance retention oil, the fragrance retention of oil in that wax, but you want to keep the modeling. You don't want to lose the modeling. That's what this is for. Vybar 343 will allow you to add more oil to your paraffin wax and maintain the modeling look of that wax. I will throw up a couple quick examples of what a modeling wax looks like. So if you're wanting to kind of maintain that look, which again, there's a market for that type of candle, then you would need to use something like this. Because if you were to just buy a paraffin modeling wax and you want to increase the amount of oil that it can hold and add some Vybar like this, you're going to lose all your modeling. But you can maintain that look by using this Vybar instead. So hopefully that wasn't too confusing. I will try to simplify this in the description of what each Vybar is for, but there's tons of information about Vybar and which type should be used for which application. But I did want to explain what it's for and why you would use each one. Now, what are the pros and cons and the reasons to use Vybar? Well, we just covered the main reason. And believe it or not, that is the primary purpose of Vybar. And that is to increase fragrance retention. In other words, to increase the amount or the capacity of oil that a wax can hold. And this is particularly for paraffin candles, because paraffin doesn't naturally hold as much fragrance oil without having it kind of seep out without using something like Vybar. So what about soy wax, you might be asking? Well, soy has a higher capacity for fragrance retention already, but there are times when if you add too much, it will seep out. That might be a reason to add a little Vybar to it. Soy doesn't typically need Vybar for the same reasons that paraffin does, but it can help kind of keep in that oil a little bit more and retain that oil a little bit more if you're struggling, but because you're using so much oil. But I would also kind of just caution you on that, because if you're using so much oil that a soy wax can't even hold it, you're probably already on the upper echelon of the amount you should be adding anyways. Adding more and more oil once you get over a certain amount really isn't going to keep increasing your fragrance throw at the same rate. So there's something called the law of diminishing returns. And what the law of diminishing returns basically states, and this is kind of an economic term that really refers to, at some point after you continue to invest money, you're going to reach a point where any additional investment of funds or energy into something is not going to lead to the same results that you were getting before. A simpler way to put that is, at some point, the level of benefit or profit that you're receiving from investment, whether it's time or money or energy, at some point, that benefit will not be worth the investment, or it will be less than what is invested. And so fragrance oil and candles work the same way. Let's say that for every 1% of fragrance oil you add, you're getting a 10% additional hot throw. And you keep doing that, and you keep doing that up to, say, 8%, 9%. And everything's great. Well, at some point, once you've reached a percentage of oil and you continue to throw more at it, you're really not going to get additional hot throw from it. If anything, you just get more wicking issues and other problems. And so you've kind of reached that point of diminishing returns. You might throw more oil into the wax, but you're not really getting any more value out of it, or at least not very much value out of it. And so you're just kind of throwing away money and making your life harder in other areas like wicking without seeing the benefits of the additional oil. Again, that's a whole nother conversation as well, but I just want to caution you that if you're thinking about using Vybar because you want to stretch 10% to 12% or 11% to 13% or something like that, I would just caution you on that, because you're already using such a high amount of oil that if you're not getting the results you're after, I would consider looking at a different oil, possibly changing your wicking or your wax, whatever. But Vybar isn't the answer for hot throw. That is the myth that I want to talk about today with Vybar. Most of the time I see Vybar mentioned, the question is usually asked, does Vybar help with scent throw? Well, the simplest answer is no. And that is because the point of Vybar is to increase fragrance retention or fragrance oil capacity in a wax, the amount it can hold, not how well it throws the scent or how well it throws the fragrance. And those are, I know those seem almost like the same thing, but they're not. There are waxes that can hold 10% oil, but don't throw anywhere near as good as waxes that hold 6% oil. So how well a wax throws fragrance is a different factor than how much oil a wax can hold. And so that is the purpose of Vybar, increasing the amount a wax can hold without fragrance seeping out of your wax. That is the purpose of Vybar, not to enhance or increase scent throw. Now, in kind of an indirect way, some people argue that it is helping scent throw if it's allowing you to add more fragrance. And so if you want to look at it from that perspective, then sure, if you have a candle with that can only hold 5% normally, or if you have a wax that can only hold 5% normally, and you add Vybar, now it can hold 7%, well then sure, that would be a case to say that me using Vybar has increased my scent throw because I was able to add more fragrance oil to my wax. But that is an indirect kind of link. The Vybar didn't increase or enhance the throw ability of your wax. It just allowed you to add more to it. But that isn't the only thing that Vybar does. Another benefit of Vybar is it increases color retention and distribution as well, which also increases the color opacity in your candle. Vybar, for the same reason it kind of distributes and maintains fragrance oil capacity, does the same thing with color as well. It'll almost feel like it's stretching your color a little bit further. It will cause a little bit more vivid and deep, rich colors, as well as better distribute the color through your wax evenly. And so if you're looking for those deep, rich, vivid colors, Vybar is another additive that you could consider using. If you're looking for a lighter or pastel type of color, then I would avoid Vybar because it's going to be harder to achieve that result because it's going to want to richen those colors up. And then another side effect of using Vybar, and this could be good or bad, depending on your purpose and your goals, is that Vybar will increase the hardness of your wax and consequently also the melt point of your wax. Now, it's not going to do it in significant amounts, but it can take a wax of 120 melt point, for example, up to, 122 to 125, somewhere in that range, depending on what wax and how much you're using. It can also harden up your waxes. So let's say you're trying to accomplish some layering with your candles, but maybe the wax you're using is so soft that it doesn't really layer really well. It almost kind of mushes together. You could consider throwing maybe 1% of Vybar in it and seeing if you can get some harder lines on your layers. Vybar will increase the hardness of your wax as well as the melt point by a degree or two potentially. Container candles, you generally want a softer wax because you want it to adhere to the side walls. You want it to melt easily across the top. You want to be able to achieve melt pools fairly easily. So with all that being said, here's the biggest thing you should be aware of when considering using Vybar. Because the purpose of Vybar is to increase the retention of oil in your wax, essentially what it's doing is it's opening up those molecules a little bit more. It's allowing that wax to grab and distribute that oil a little bit better. And then it almost kind of sucks it in and then kind of traps it in, and it doesn't allow it to seep out. So let's use an analogy to kind of explain what Vybar is doing. Imagine taking a Ziploc bag that is open and you just kind of sit it on the counter and you start filling it up with water, right? It's going to continue to hold that water. The water is going to start filling up that bag. But at some point, if you overfill the bag a little bit, even if it's just a little, some of it's going to start leaking out because the bag is open. It's serving as a container, but it's not really sealed. It's not really trapping that water in. So if you fill it up enough, water will start to seep out. And that water is going to start leaking out of that bag without it being full, right? Because if you've got the bag sitting, laying down on the counter and you start filling it up, it'll start holding some. But before it's able to really fill up all the way, you're going to start potentially leaking some of that water out of the bag. Well, Vybar basically seals that bag up. So what that means is you could fill that bag up all the way with water, as much as it can hold, and then it seals it in. So not only did it allow more in it, but now it's kept it from really seeping out. That is what Vybar does with fragrance oil in a wax. It allows you to fill up more and then keep it in, which sounds great in theory, and it is a good thing. That's why Vybar is used in a lot of blended waxes, and in most waxes from our suppliers, Vybar is already added in. But what's the consequence of that? Well, if something is sealed so tightly in, it's harder for it to get out, right? So let's change out the water in that Ziploc bag analogy to flowers. If that bag is open, even though it's holding less in it, you could smell the flowers fairly easily, right? It's an open bag, the flowers are exposed, and they're going to be able to get out of the bag easier. You can smell them. If you zip that bag up, sure, you are able to stuff more flowers in, but you're going to have a harder time smelling it. And that is because now it's a lot harder for that fragrance to get out. That is my warning with Vybar. Vybar is also going to trap in the oils a little bit more if you use too much. Now we have to kind of break away from the analogy here with a Ziploc bag. I guess the equivalent here would be almost just use enough Vybar to partially Ziploc the bag if you want to run with that analogy. But the main point is, if you're going to use Vybar, do not use too much, because if you use too much, it can actually backfire and hurt your scent throw. Because if you use too much, it's going to trap in that fragrance so tightly that it's really going to struggle to be able to escape the wax and get into the air for everyone to smell it. So if you're going to use Vybar, make sure you're using the recommended amount, which is anywhere from 0.5% to 2% by weight. But most importantly, make sure the wax you're using doesn't already have Vybar in it. If you're choosing a wax, especially a pre-blended parasoy or paraffin from one of your suppliers, chances are it already has Vybar. IGI 6006, for example, already has Vybar. So make sure you ask your supplier if that wax already has Vybar in it, because if you add more in addition to what's already in it, it's going to probably backfire. There are waxes that do not have Vybar in it. Most of your soys don't have Vybar in it. And in fact, most soy blends that are heavier on the soy side do not have Vybar. If they don't, and you're struggling with oil seeping out, and you want to consider adding Vybar, just reach out and just double check that there is no Vybar in it. And then you can experiment with using a little bit and see if it provides any good results for you. But even if it doesn't have the Vybar in it, just stick to the recommended usage amounts. All right, so that's probably enough Vybar talk for the day. I'm sure I said Vybar about 500 times by now, but hopefully you found this information helpful and valuable, maybe cleared up some of the questions you had about it and when to use it, and also some of the confusion on what its purpose is. If you found value in this video and you're interested in learning more about candle making and candle business, I would encourage you to subscribe by hitting the subscribe button below, as well as the bell notification, so you are alerted when I post future videos. Again, thank you for stopping by, and we'll see you next time.